Welcome to our deep learning lecture. Today we want to talk about regularization a bit more. The first topic that I want to introduce are some ideas on normalization.
The stuff that works best is really simple.
So why could normalization be a problem? So let's see at some original data here. A typical approach is that you subtract the mean and then you can also normalize the variance. And this is very useful because then we are in an expected range with regarding the input. Of course, if you do these normalizations, then you want to use them only on the training data to calculate this normalization. So there's also normalization within networks, and this is achieved by batch normalization. The idea in batch normalization is that you add a new layer with two new parameters, gamma and beta, and at the input of the layer, you start measuring the mean and the standard deviation of the batch. So what you do is you compute over the mini batch the current mean and standard deviation, and then you use that to normalize the activations of the input to this layer to have a zero mean and a unit standard deviation. So this is calculated on the fly throughout the training process, and then you scale at the output of the layer with the trainable weights, beta and gamma. You scale them appropriately as desired for the next layers. So this nice feature can, of course, only be done during the training. If you want to move on then towards test time, you do, after you finish the training, you compute the mean and the standard deviation in the batch normalization layer once, and you keep it then constant for all future applications of the network. Of course, mu and sigma are vectors, and they have exactly the same dimension as the activation vector. If you pair this with convolutional layers, the batch normalization is slightly different by using a scalar and a sigma for every channel. So there's a slight difference if you use it in convolutional layers. So you may argue, why does batch normalization actually help? And there's overwhelming practical evidence that it's really a useful tool. This has been originally motivated by the internal covariate shift. So the problem that the ReLU is not zero-centered was identified, and then also initialization and input distribution may not be normalized, and therefore the input distribution shifts over time. In deeper nets, you even get amplified effects. So as a result, the layers constantly have to adapt, and then this leads to slow learning. Now, if you look at these observations closely, there is very little concrete evidence to support this theory.
We are happy that it works better than any competing method, but that doesn't mean that we think we are done.
On NeurIPS 2018, there was a paper on how does batch normalization help optimization. And here they showed that batch normalization is effective even if you introduce an internal covariate shift after the batch normalization layer again. So still in these situations, batch normalization helped. They could show experimentally that the batch normalization smooths the loss landscape, which is very nice for the optimization. And also, it helped to increase the Lipschitzness of the loss function and the gradient. The Lipschitz constant is the highest slope that occurs in the function. And if you improve the Lipschitzness, it essentially means that high slopes do no longer occur. So this is in line with smoothing the loss landscape. And they even could provide a proof for this property in the paper, which is very interesting.
There's nothing more practical than a good theory.
So batch normalization improves stability with respect to hyperparameters, initialization, convergence, and similar properties, by the way, can also be observed for LP normalization. So that's also one way to go. There's generalizations of batch normalization. You can calculate the mu and the sigma over activations of a batch, over a layer, over spatial dimensions, over a group, over weights of layer. So there's many different variations of batch normalization, and that's also a very powerful tool.
what is clear to me is that engineers and companies and labs and grad students will continue to tune architectures and explore all kinds of tweaks to make the current state of the art ever slightly better.
Another tool that is also very effective are the self-normalizing neural networks. It also addresses the stability problem of stochastic gradient descent. And the key element here is the scaled exponential linear unit that we already discussed in the activation functions. So here we have the definition again. And with the particular setting for lambda and for alpha, we can ensure the property that a zero mean and unit standard deviation input will have the same mean and standard deviation at the output of the layer. So this is guaranteed to keep these properties, and then the result is that stable activations also lead to stable training. One thing that has to be changed is the dropout procedure. We'll talk about dropout in a couple of slides, but here, instead of dropping to zero, you have to drop to minus lambda times alpha. And additionally, they use an affine transform to restore the variance and the mean. So this self-normalizing neural network concept in some extent also resembles the batch normalization. And interestingly, it also leads to increased stability and is also a good recipe that you may want to consider when building your neural networks. Now, we already talked about dropout. Dropout is also a very important technology that is being used in deep networks. And one thing that you may want to consider is all of the elements during training, of course, they depend on each other. So if you have correlated inputs, then also the adaptation will run in a similar way. But if you want to have independent features that allow you to recognize different things, then you somehow have to break the correlation between the features. And this can actually be performed by dropout. And dropout is essentially the idea that you randomly kill some of the neurons and just set them to zero. So you select a probability P and you randomly then set activations to zero with probability 1 minus P. Then during test time, of course, you have to multiply all of the activations with P, because otherwise you would have a too high activation in the next layer. Yeah? So you have to compensate for this dropout effect at the test time. An interesting concept here is, of course, that if you use this dropout, let's say Y1 and Y2 in this example, they would be correlated, so they carry the same information. Now, if I use them and try to train them, they will never learn something else because they always produce the same output. And because they produce the same output in the backpropagation, they will get the same update, so they will always stay correlated. Now, if you introduce this dropout procedure, you randomly kill some of the neurons, which means that during the training procedure, they also get the weights drawn into a different direction, and therefore they will no longer be correlated. So you can break these internal correlations using dropout, and this has shown to reduce problems with overfitting and so on. So this is really a very important concept that quite frequently is used in deep learning.
And, you know, nothing in machine learning is exact, right?
Also interesting is a generalization that is drop connect. Here you don't kill all of the activations of an individual neuron, but you kill the individual connections. So you randomly identify connections that are set to zero. And this could be seen as a generalization of dropout because you have more different ways of adjusting it. Typically, the implementation is not as efficient because you have to implement this masking. It's simpler just to set one of the activations to zero. There's not much that you have to do in the implementation. In the masking, there you have to devise the mask, you have to multiply with the mask, and so on.
Machine learning is the science of sloppiness, really.
Okay, so we already talked about these common concepts in normalization, but that's not all tricks of the trade. We still have a couple of cards up in our sleeves. So these tricks I will show you in the next lecture. Thank you very much for listening. Goodbye.